Next match on the card we have is the Wacky Gonzo's Stadium Stampede match with the Blackpool Combat Club. Santana and Ortiz out first with BCC in custom peacoats and sunglasses. As Nigel referenced, the absence of American Dragon Brittle Danielson. Best friends, Eddie Kingston and Penta, were out. And then Kingston shoved everyone. Kingston came out, and this was according to Ricky Cage, who was there and immediately fucking hit me up about it. Kingston came out, and the crowd came alive.
Yeah, because they wanted to see him.
Yes.
And then you know what happened? He promptly disappeared for 10 to 15 minutes.
Well, they had to go finish that sandwich in the back.
Just go. Like, dude.
This was a bad match because of production. I'll agree with Nick. Nick has been fucking firing on production all night in the chat, but he's right. This is one of those matches that with the picture-in-picture that AEW and even WWE do, this was the time that you bring out two other cameras, maybe one on the right, one on the left, or two on the right. You know what I mean? And you have the main match. You have the ring centered, so everybody who sees that the big screen is the ring, but then you have two little camera shots following the other wrestlers. I just felt like it was a whole state of confusion because when everybody was fighting in the back and around the ring, and it's like you didn't really know what was going on, which is what the Stadium Stampede suffers from a lot of the time.
Yeah, and you didn't get to see 60% of the match.
Well, it's either you keep the fucking camera on the ring the whole time and you just don't see anything else, or they flip it back and forth on one screen 1,000 times and everybody gets fucking epilepsy. You know what I mean? It's like, can we come up with a happy medium? Which I think the happy medium is the picture-in-picture. Just give us two small little screens on the side.
It's the closest you can get. But then also at the same time, I'm watching this and there's guys taking bumps onto fucking Legos and people can't even see it.
Right.
They can't even see where it's happening. Like, it's nonsense. It's fucking foolishness. A match like this reminds me of when like a big comedian comes to town, whoever it might be. Like when Chappelle, right? Chappelle or Chris Rock or fucking Kevin Hart, any of these people that sell stadiums and arenas, right? Even if I want to see those comics, I don't want to see them in that setting because to me, it takes something away from the whole presentation of it.
Right.
Because a comedian doing their act, I want to be able to see them. I want them to look out. Like it's a more intimate thing and it's just... It makes it either more aggressive, more funny. You can get caught in the energy, right?
Sure.
And it's the same thing as matches like this in a way, where if you're all over and there's blood and there's fucking boom, bing, boom, 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 and there's 80,000 people watching it, they're missing half the shit.
Right.
You're a half mile up in the fucking... What are you doing up there, dude?
Now, see, this is
the binoculars, you know, watching Wheeler Yuta do a fucking front flip onto somebody? Like, what... there's no point to it. Do you see where I'm going? Like, I don't get it.
It's too much to focus on when everybody's in different areas.
Yeah.
And the only thing I can think of is maybe the monitors, and we can ask Ricky this later too, but maybe the monitors that were around the actual ringside. First off, can we talk about that for half a second?
Yeah.
The setup for All In, the way everything was set up, seemed to not really be a great setup because they had the giant tarp over the top and the long black fucking, I don't know, I guess it was supposed to be the speakers and everything else with the actual monitors. It looked like it was blocking. Anybody that was in the upper tier must have just had to watch the monitors.
Yeah, that's all I am.
Like, they wouldn't have been able to see the ring. Like, especially if you're...
That's inevitable when a building that big, though, Mish, you know?
Like, maybe it is. I don't know. I don't know if there was another way to set it up. It just seemed like, man, there's just a lot of dead spots for people that paid hard-earned money to be at this fucking thing.
Right. Well, this is, once again, going back to what I'm saying, though, you're going to miss so much stuff. This is why having matches like this in an environment like the way that the show is presented and... People aren't going to, they're not seeing any of it. And you're risking these guys are bumping on concrete. They're right. Going through tables. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, you're taking all these fucking hard bumps for what? There was a random point in this where Santana, who, God love him, another guy, top 10 list of people, is, AEW's wasting. He would make it. Maybe he'd be 11. Yeah. I like the guy. But there's just a point where there's two tables set up and then he's on a ladder. And then Penta jumps onto the ladder. The ladder collapses. And then for whatever particular reason, They both just climb the ladder again.
Yeah.
For no. Hey, the thing broke. You know what?
Let's do it again.
Let's do it again. Yeah. Let's do it again, pal. Which I saw that and I'm like, dude, Santana, I like you. I'm cheering for you. Penta, love you. Loved you in fucking Lucha Underground. But what is this?
Penta.
The fuck is that?
Penta's mid-match wardrobe change into Eviler Penta. I was like, oh, okay.
This shit like this. Oh, my God. Shit like this just fucking makes me just cringe.
Oh, but
and not in the way of like, ooh, it's so bloody invaded, but like just it's stupid. It's fucking stupid.
But you're forgetting the most important part of the match when Orange Cassidy became Blood Orange Cassidy when he got stabbed with a fork multiple times by Ortiz. Rake that down his face, which was weird seeing. It was weird seeing Orange Cassidy with the crimson mask. I will say God. That was a little wild.
Well, what was the part? I forgot what happened in this where John Moxley took a bunch of and then kicked out at one, and the crowd's just completely.
Oh, when he took the shish kebabs to the head.
Yeah,
and he showed that off. That was lovely. I got hungry at that point. I'm like, man, shish kebabs do sound good for lunch.
Mm. Yeah. He sucks. He is fucking terrible, dude. He is such a fucking bad wrestler. It's unreal.
But
yeah,
he's not. It's another case of we know he's not.
I'm. You know what? You can only show me something for so long. You can only be like, I'm an asshole. So many times. I don't care if you are a nice person. If you tell me you're an asshole 600 times, eventually I'm going to be like, I guess you're an asshole.
Right.
Because that's what Moxley has become.
Well, that's the thing is he does what he wants to do here. Maybe he never wanted.
And drags 15 people along with it always.
Maybe he never wanted to be a good technical guy. He's capable of it. It's kind of like, remember when Hulk Hogan used to throw a drop kick? No, that's because Hulk Hogan didn't like to do it. He did it like twice in his career, and then he never did it again. And it's like, we know he's capable of a drop kick, but he'd rather just throw the leg drop, brother. Oh, you know, that's what this is. John Moxley is more your Hulk Hogan than CM Punk is. John Moxley is capable of so much more. He's capable of great matches. We've seen it. He just doesn't want to do that in AEW.
I don't know if it's so much more as much as it is he has the ability to. God, I don't even know if he does anymore, Mitch. I just don't like.
Oh,
he cuts these stupid promos. He drags all these people. Poor Cesaro, another guy sitting there thumbing his ass. What the fuck's he doing there? God, it's just really bad matches, nonsensical. Bullshit all over the place.
Oh.
And I'm sorry, the finish is completely unavoidable to not discuss in this situation.
Can we not forget about Sue driving into the stadium with the minivan?
Yes, because that's in the middle of our blood, bleed, blad match. Yes. Here comes an old lady in a minivan because it's so funny.
And Moxley had to kiss her. Moxley had to give her the big old kiss.
God. Yeah. And once again, you know, here we have this moment. Eddie Kingston comes out,
yes,
and the whole fucking stadium loses their mind. He disappears for 10 minutes. Why? Don't know.
Right.
Just disappears. The guy who's the most fucking getting the biggest reaction as a babyface in the match. Where does he go? No idea. He comes back into the match. Him and Claudio have this big thing between each other, right? They hate each other so much. Who eats the pin?
That would be Eddie Kingston, sir.
No.
Oh, no, Claudio. Sorry, Claudio ate the pin from Orange Cassidy. Him? Orange Cassidy.
Fucking Orange Cassidy.
Dude, that was, come on. I fucking called that from a million miles away weeks ago. We knew this was going to happen. You knew Orange Cassidy was going to win this. He is the golden child. He is Tony Khan's personal golden child.
I hope that I say it every fucking month now. I say it at least once a month. And I say it with no hate in my heart. I really hope these two are romantically involved. I really do. I hope that this is his boyfriend. I hope they hold hands. I hope they kiss. I hope they go on trips together.
Well, what's the alternative?
And they frolic in the sand and hug.
But
because he loves him. He's madly in love with this fucking guy.
But you're missing the alternative, Joe. You're missing the alternative of this because maybe they're not. Maybe they are strictly a professional relationship, and Tony Khan looks at Orange Cassidy and says, "You're my John Cena. You're my Hulk Hogan. You're my The Ooh. Rock. You're my Stone Cold Steve Austin. This company should have been built around Orange Cassidy."
No, I hope he's his boyfriend. All that said, nope. I hope they're in love. Because this is how, like, what the fuck is this?
Maybe
like,
it's HBK, yeah, Ted. Maybe you're right. That's a little closer, actually. Maybe Orange Cassidy is Tony
Khan. Yeah, same thing, his boyfriend. Like, no. It's, once again, none of which I'm saying this with any sort of trepidations or hate in my heart or anger. I'm saying this as you are treating this person like they're the greatest fucking wrestler of all time. He doesn't lose. He beats five men. Right. He gets stabbed in the head 10 times. He fucking flies out. There's four other people in the ring. You have people on his team who Eddie Kingston is a brawler with a longstanding feud against the guy that ate the pin. But Orange Cassidy wins.
Right.
He takes.
Right.
What the fuck? What the actual fuck?
I think Tony just believes in this guy that much. Like, I understand that the joke is like, oh, well, hopefully they're, you know, in a relationship. But
just put the title on him. If you love him this much, I'm not even being fucking hyperbolic. Put the title on him. If you love this guy so much that he gets to beat everyone for two straight years and kick out of every move, people twice his size.
Because he's the ultimate underdog. He's the guy.
Not if he wins everything.
I understand that, but that's why. That's how he keeps him away from it. It's the Mikey Whipwreck curse. Like, instead of him losing everything, he wins everything, but he never gets a title. Whipwreck lost everything, but got a title. You know what I mean?
Does Tony Khan think Patrick Mahomes is an underdog, too?
Maybe.
Is that what you think?
Maybe.
He's like, God damn, I hope that kid can pull it off this year.
Dan Marino was his favorite football player.
I love Tom Brady. He's just the perpetual underdog. You know, no one ever thought.
Well, no, because he's got wins. It wouldn't count. Nobody called Tom Brady an underdog.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Orange Cassidy is like 175-3.
Yeah, but he doesn't have a title. He doesn't have the title.
Here's a good point.
He doesn't have the title.
International title.
Right. He's got that. That Midwest Cleveland, Ohio belt or some shit like that?
I don't know, but this match was the fucking worst thing of the night by a lot. And the fact that, once again, Eddie Kingston comes back, big ovation, people happy to see him in the other buildings, and they're happy to see him in Wembley, and then he just pieces out and doesn't even take the pin in the match on the guy who he's been feuding with forever. Fucking idiotic. Yeah. Fucking.
Follow WrestleSoup on Twitter. At Wrestling Soup. Like and subscribe to Wrestling Soup on YouTube. And check out the Discord for live chat during the shows at discord.gg/wrestlingsoup. Check out and subscribe to the shows on Apple, Amazon, iHeartRadio, Spotify,
and more.